Hello students, today I am going to start with the fourth chapter of our syllabus, that is lasers. This is a chapter which has a GTU weightage of 19%. Let us start with the brief introduction of laser and its important characteristics. So laser basically is an acronym, it is a short form. It is a short form for L stands for light, A stands for amplification, S for stimulated, E for emission, R for radiation. So the full form of laser is light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. You know what is light? It is a form of electromagnetic radiation. Amplify means to intensify something, to increase the amplitude of a quantity. What do you mean by the word stimulated, or rather I would say stimulated emission? Emission means to emit. The output is known as emission, generally in the form of light. But what exactly is stimulated emission, we'll be discussing in the coming videos. And radiation, again, is a form of light. So full form of laser is a very important one marker question, generally asked as an MCQ or as a one marker question. Full form: the intensity of light is amplified by stimulated emission. So basically, laser is a sort of, is a form of light which is very intense. You can say a highly intense form of radiation. And this high intensity, this intensity is achieved by the process called stimulated emission. So now I'll be discussing the most important topic of the chapter, a question which is generally in the range of 3 to 4 marks. It states characteristics of laser. Characteristics means the properties of laser. So very, very important topic from the chapter. Laser basically has 4 properties or 4 important characteristics. The first one of them is known as coherence. Coherence is a word. What do you mean by coherence? Now, coherence is a very important characteristic if we consider laser. What exactly is the meaning of coherence? Coherence means, now see, light consists of small packets of radiation, and these small packets are known as photons. So coherence means if you consider any form of light, if all the photons which constitute a wave, if all photons are identical in phase and direction, we say the light is coherent. See, I've written here, the wave trains in laser are identical, that is same in phase and direction. Now, all constituent photons, that is small packets of light, they have same energy, same momentum. What is momentum? Product of mass and velocity. And they propagate in the same direction. That is the reason we say laser is coherent. So here I just tried to show the difference between coherent and incoherent light. So let us first see what is incoherent light. You can see this, suppose this is one photon moving in this direction, another photon, so all photons are random, they are scattered. But if on the other hand you see this laser source, that is a coherent light source, you can see all are having the same phase, all are moving in the same direction, and all are having the same momentum. So such a form of light is known as coherent. To be more specific, I have again shown like this. See, they have a constant wavelength also. Phase is also same, direction is also same, the wavelength is also same. So such type of photons are known as coherent photons. Because of the property of coherence, laser can be amplified. If all photons move in same direction, if all photons are of same phase and same amplitude, only then you can amplify it. If these photons are scattered, amplification would be very difficult. So laser can be amplified because of the property called coherence. Let us discuss the second property of laser, that is known as high intensity. What is intensity? Intensity of a light wave, or intensity in general, it is the energy per unit time flowing through a unit area. If we are discussing laser, that is a form of light, we will say intensity will be the light energy per unit time flowing per unit area. Now, due to the coherent nature of laser, it can focus on a very, very small area of 10 raised to minus 6 centimeters square. you can just imagine a very small dot. If you consider this dot, 10 raised to minus 6 is smaller than this dot. Yani, you can say that, means you can say that all the photons can focus on this small area. Just assume how much intense the energy would be. So a very high concentration of its energy over a small area. This leads to very high intensity. And because of this property, we can say that laser is used in melting, cutting, welding, drilling, these applications. We'll be discussing the applications in the later part of the chapter. Let us discuss the third characteristic of laser, that is known as high directionality. Directionality means a proper direction. Now, high directionality, an ordinary light source emits light in all possible directions, as I just shown an incoherent example. So, laser light travels as a parallel beam over a long distance without spreading. Laser doesn't spread, that because it is coherent. That is the reason it is intense also, and it is directional also. Now, for any ordinary light, we say that it travels as a parallel beam up to a distance of d square by lambda. What is d? It is the diameter of aperture, diameter of the source of light, and lambda is the wavelength of light. So, up to a distance, up to this ratio, the distance equal to this ratio, light will travel as a parallel beam, and then it spreads. And it spreads radially. Radially means in a spherical manner. Now, the angular spread for an ordinary light, it is defined as delta theta is equals to lambda upon d, wavelength upon diameter of aperture. For ordinary light, it is generally 1 meter per 1 meter. But for a laser beam, it is 1 mm per 1 meter. Let me just clarify this using a diagram. Suppose I have any ordinary light, I can say that this is the aperture. So starting from here, if I consider a distance of 1 meter, spreading will also be 1 meter. Whereas on the other hand, if you consider laser, if you consider from the aperture the distance as 1 meter, the spreading is only 1 mm. Do not just compare the dimensions. I have just tried to show you the difference that this spread is 1 meter. On the other hand, this spread is 1 mm. And that is the reason we say that laser is directional. And because of this property, because of high directionality, we can say that laser is used as a ranging device and it is used in the study of planetary objects. You can use laser, you know, through laser from one planet to the other. For long, long distance communications, laser is used. The last property of laser is monochromaticity, high monochromaticity. Monochromatic source means a source which has a single color. If you consider white light is known as a polychromatic source. Why polychromatic source? Because it has more than one color. Right? But on the other hand, if you consider laser is known as a highly monochromatic source. Monochromaticity means source with a single color. Now, degree of monochromaticity, it actually depends. It can be quantitatively described in terms of wavelength bandwidth. You can say that lower or narrower the, what do you mean by bandwidth? Different values, the range of wavelengths. So, narrow is the wavelength bandwidth, higher will be the monochromaticity. And for a laser, this bandwidth is in terms of nanometers. Nanometers means 10 raised to minus 9 meters. So there is hardly any spread of bandwidth. You can say it is very, very narrow. And because it is very, very narrow, we say that laser has a very high monochromaticity. Angular spread of laser is also very small and it has a coherent nature also. And that is the reason we have laser as a highly monochromatic source. We can say that laser means one wavelength, one frequency. Next, I'll just try to brief you the difference between ordinary light and laser light. So, ordinary light angular spread is more, as we've just discussed, 1 meter per 1 meter. Laser light angular spread is less. Ordinary light, they're not directional. Laser light is directional. Ordinary light is less intense. Laser light is highly intense. Ordinary light is not coherent beam and it is not in phase. No photons are in phase. But if you consider laser, it is a coherent beam and all photons are in phase. Radiation is monochromatic and in case of laser, the radiation is monochromatic. Some examples of ordinary light like sunlight, mercury vapor lamp, and some examples of laser light like CO2 laser, ruby laser, etc. Now let us move on to Einstein's theory. Einstein was the physicist, was the scientist who first explained that laser, who first explained laser on the basis of quantum theory of light. And according to him, he says that laser is a consequence of interaction of radiation with matter. Radiation means light or energy. Matter means anything that has space, that occupies space, is called matter. So according to Einstein, he says that whenever these two, whenever radiation and matter interact, the consequence is laser. How? We'll see further. Radiation interacts with matter under appropriate conditions, and this may lead to transition of an atom or a molecule from one energy state to another. Because of the interaction of radiation and matter, there can be two possibilities. Either radiation will give its energy to matter, or the matter already has energy and it will release the energy. So, basis on this statement, if the transition is from higher state to lower state, the system will give its part of energy. However, if the transition is from lower state to higher state, we say that the system has absorbed energy. The interaction of radiation and matter can take place by three possible ways, according to Einstein. One of them is absorption, also known as induced absorption. The other two are the types of emission processes. They are commonly known as spontaneous emission and stimulated emission. What he actually said was, matter, or suppose I consider a material. If the material, if the atoms in the material are not having energy, I expose it to radiation. What will happen? They will absorb energy and move on to a higher level. Whereas already the electrons or already the atoms are present in higher level, because all of them are having energy, they will be highly unstable. So definitely they will release their energy. So according to him, either the process can be absorption or the process can be emission. But he classified the emission into two categories, spontaneous and stimulated. To understand the above three processes, what we will be doing is, we will be considering two energy levels only, namely E1, that is the lower energy level, E2, that is the higher energy level. We will be considering only one atom in a system. This is just an assumption because no material has single atom. And we will be considering only one photon. We represent energy of a photon as h nu. So let me start with my first process, that is induced absorption. What do you mean by the word induce? Induce means the thing which does not happen on its own. It is forced. You have to initiate it by some manner. So what is induced absorption? The definition first, if a photon of energy h nu is incident on an atom, which is in lower energy state E1 that we have already assumed, the atom absorbs the incident photon and it gets excited to a higher energy level E2. This process is known as induced absorption. In general, I can say absorption means from a lower level to a higher level. So in the form of a diagram also I have explained, this is a scenario before absorption. There is only one atom in lower energy state E1. Nothing is present in the higher energy state because there is no energy. Just an example, your phone has discharged. Without any charger, without any power supply, can it charge on its own? No. So this atom is idle. It is in lower energy state. Without any external energy, it can never move to a higher level. So suppose an energy is incident on this atom. What will happen? This atom which was earlier in lower state will absorb this energy and will move on to the higher energy state E2. So I can just write the after absorption process as, I had an atom, it absorbed a photon, and it leads to atom star. Atom star indicates that atom is in excited state or in a higher energy level. Now this, suppose I say there is only one atom and energy is incident, only one atom will move here. But suppose I have 10 atoms here and energy is incident, so 10 atoms will move to a higher energy level. So I can say that this upward transition, why do we say it upward? Because it is from a lower level to a higher level. So this rate of upward transition, because it is from E1 to E2, we denote this rate as R12. 12 means from level 1 to level 2. So the rate of upward transition R12 from ground state E1 to excited state E2 is proportional to the population of lower energy level. Population of lower energy level means number of atoms present here. As I just said, one atom is present, one will move. 10 are present, 10 will move. 100 are present, 100 will move. And it also depends on density of radiation. We denote it as rho. So we can say that R12 is proportional to N1 into rho, where N1 is the population, means number of atoms in E1, rho is the density of population. I remove this proportionality sign and I can write it as R12 is equals to B12 N1 rho. Now this B12 is a proportionality constant defined by Einstein, and this B12 is known as probability of induced absorption per unit time. So please remember this B12, this constant is important because further videos we will be discussing Einstein's theory, the derivation part. I'll be completing the next two processes in the next video. Hope till here the topic was clear. Thank you.